Hello, I'm Sona Chikarmane, and I'm here with Kathy Geiss, and we're both breast imagers at the Brigham and Women's Hospital Division of Breast Imaging, and we are going to talk about today non-mass findings on breast ultrasound, the definitions, classifications, and etiologies. We'll have a couple learning objectives over the next few minutes. We'll talk about the definition and the various proposed classification systems for non-mass findings on breast ultrasound. We'll show you some examples of the sonographic features of non-mass findings. We'll correlate them on ultrasound with mammographic findings. And finally, we'll discuss some of the benign and malignant etiologies for non-mass ultrasound findings. Non-mass finding on ultrasound is not part of our current BI-RADS ultrasound atlas, but it is increasingly being used in the radiology literature. What it means is a sonographic finding that does not conform to a mass shape. In other words, it has non-convex borders. And the ability to recognize non-mass ultrasound findings can improve our sensitivity for lesion detection. So there are different classification systems for non-mass findings on ultrasound, and one of the earliest classification systems was developed in 2004 in Japan by the Association of Breast and Thyroid Sonology. There they described different characteristics of non-mass findings on ultrasound, including ductal dilatation, a multivesicular pattern, low echo areas, which could either be spotted or mottled, geographic or indistinct, as well as architectural distortion. Many years later, Iyamatsu et al. In Breast Cancer Journal in 2012 described basically two different areas of non-mass findings, either ductal or non-ductal. And ductal was described as duct-like areas with parallel orientation, which could either be single ductal or multiple ductal hypoechoic areas. And then non-ductal hypoechoic area, which was an area that had an indistinct shape at different projections, and it lacked that convex borders and conspicuity. The patterns could either be focal or segmental. Associated findings that they described included calcifications and distortion, and if there were multiple similar bilateral areas, these were considered normal, unless they were palpable. Another classification system by Kim et al. In 2014 described non-mass patterns and distributions, and this group decided to remove ductal because that was already described in the BI-RADS lexicon. And they described focal, which was less than one quadrant, or regional, which was greater than one quadrant. And they focused on their internal sonographic patterns, which included modeled, indistinct, and geographic, the geographic being more confluent hypoechoic area with a cobblestone appearance. Do you want to describe the others?
Sure, moving along. And also in 2014, Ko and colleagues reported four proposed types of non-mass finding on ultrasound. Type one, again, similarly to some of our other authors, was a ductal hypoechoic area with parallel orientation, plus or minus calcifications. Type two was a non-ductal hypoechoic area that was visible as a confined asymmetry with a somewhat indistinct shape on two projections. Type 3 was a vague area of altered echo texture with associated architectural distortion. And this terminology, altered echo texture, is also fairly common in clinical breast practice. And then type 4 was an indistinct hypoechoic area with posterior shadowing. The following year, Wang and his colleagues proposed a different classification system, including hypoechoic area, a hypoechoic area with or without calcifications, architectural distortion, which was described as a disorganized structure compared to normal tissue, somewhat like the altered echo texture we just talked about, and then solid echogenicity within a duct. And then finally, a few years back, Park and colleagues talked about distribution of non-mass findings, including focal, linear segmental, regional, and the possibility of having associated features, including calcifications, distortion, or abnormal ductal changes.
So what are we looking at when we're looking for non-mass findings on ultrasound? Well, we're looking at a discrete area of altered echo texture that looks different from the surrounding normal breast tissue. We want to make sure that we see it in two orthogonal planes and it has no convex margins to make sure that it's actually a true finding. Distributions vary and can include focal, linear, segmental, or regional. And as similar to non-mass enhancement on MRI, you can have normal glandular tissue or fatty tissue interspersed within the lesion. Associated sonographic findings increase detection rate as well as raise suspicion for malignancy, and these include calcifications, ductal changes, or architectural distortion.
So those are the various classification systems. We'd like to talk a little bit with imaging now, because we're radiologists, about varying internal echo texture. And that can range from predominantly hypoechoic, like the image here on the left, to a mixed hyperechoic and hypoechoic area, as this lesion parallel to the normal planes of the breast oriented, and predominantly hyperechoic with possibly smaller hypoechoic areas internally. Along with varying echo texture, we have different distributions. Again, we're back to imaging. Then that can include focal areas, as our illustration on the top shows you, linear segmental distribution, which is described as a longitudinal or triangular area arrayed in a line along a ductal distribution. And then finally, regional, which is a large geographic area not particularly conforming to a ductal or segmental distribution.
And you can see these distributions are similar to that in the Bio-Rad's lexicon described for breast MRI. There's focal, linear, and segmental, as well as regional.
So ductal architecture, as we told you, occurs in a number of the proposed classification systems. And this is just a nice example of ductal architecture in a 25-year-old with a palpable finding. She has all of these small anechoic areas aligned in a linear distribution suggestive of a duct, with some larger outpouchings or cystic dilatations around the duct. These are two more examples of ductal architecture. The image on the left happens to be DCIS, and you can see again small anechoic areas aligned in a linear distribution, and then a larger area, easier to detect, of course, on ultrasound, again with smaller anechoic sort of oblong areas suggesting a ductal orientation directed towards the nipple.
And what's interesting about these cases is that sonographically, the features and the imaging findings of the non-mass findings on ultrasound look very similar to each other. However, the pathologies are quite different, one being malignant and the other being benign.
So this is an example of a mammographic asymmetry. This is a one-view finding here indicated on the lateral side of the right CC view. There's the possible suggestion of some architectural distortion with this 2D image. And on ultrasound, this corresponds to a non-mass finding indicated here with mixed echo texture. It has some hypoechoic areas as well as some more hyperechoic areas here. And you can see it's oriented parallel to the skin surface and the normal breast tissue planes. This finding is really pretty subtle. Unless you're looking specifically for a finding in this location. I think in screening breast ultrasound, this would be very hard to pick up.
Exactly. It's a very subtle finding mammographically as well as sonographically. So non-mass findings can also be correlates for architectural distortion on mammography. In this case, you have a 57-year-old woman with a screen-detected left architectural distortion. And the correlate on ultrasound is a vague focal mixed echogenicity non-mass area. On ultrasound-guided biopsy, this ended up being a complex sclerosing lesion, which was also benign on surgical excision.
Yeah, and this is a pretty subtle ultrasound finding. I wish that all our findings had cursors on them when we were searching for them. It would certainly make it easier to detect these things.
Here's another example of tomo-only left architectural distortion detected on screening mammography with a very subtle hypoechoic area, non-mass area on ultrasound. Ultrasound-guided biopsy demonstrated invasive carcinoma with ductal and lobular features grade 2.
Again, quite subtle.
Mm-hmm. No calipers that time.
So another example of mammographic architectural distortion with a correlate of non-mass finding on ultrasound. Now in this example, it's predominantly hypoechoic. We're showing you two orthogonal images. And on the image on the right, you can see this is a pretty nondescript finding, sort of a little oblong hypoechoic area, but when turning on it orthogonally, you can see that this is truly a three-dimensional correlate. Looks a little more suspicious on the left-hand picture. And this represented atypical ductal hyperplasia both on ultrasound core biopsy as well as subsequent surgical excision.
And as you mentioned, it's really important to see non-mass findings on two orthogonal planes to confirm that it's a real finding, because on one image it looks like it could be the surrounding tissue.
So posterior acoustic shadowing as an associated finding can help the radiologist in picking up these sometimes subtle findings. And in this example, this is a non-mass finding which does have shadowing. That's the first thing that really catches the radiologist's eye when they're scanning. But what's important to recognize is that the finding is not just due to the shadowing, it's also this accompanying altered echo texture here. You can see she's got a hyperechoic rim, if you will, here, as well as a more hypoechoic area anteriorly. And this was an invasive lobular cancer, which is a fairly common histopathology for these non-mass findings when malignant.
So non-mass findings in ultrasound can also be sonographic correlates for findings on MRI. In this case, it's a screening breast MRI in a high-risk patient, and there's a focal area of heterogeneous NME in the left breast, which had a correlative area of architectural distortion on mammography. And you can see on ultrasound, the correlate has a lot of dense posterior shadowing. But if you look at the actual finding, you can see that there's a more mixed echogenicity area of non-mass finding here. And this was biopsies and showed to be malignant. This is another great case of a non-mass finding being a correlate for an MRI area of focal NME. You can see here, this is a 61-year-old who had a prior history of left breast cancer. And on her screening MRI in the left breast, you can see this plaque-like NME along the pectoralis muscle, and there's pectoralis enhancement as well as enhancement of the pleura. So we did a targeted ultrasound, and we see here an area of non-mass finding, and quite subtle again, and the calipers help. This was biopsied under ultrasound and found to be grade 3 IDC.
Right. Yeah, and so this is a challenging lesion. Again, if you were performing a screening study, it might be hard to detect this as a discrete finding. It's much more evident when you know you're looking for a specific finding to correlate with your MRI. So distortion as an associated finding is important to recognize sonographically because distortion can indicate those pathologic changes that are causing ductal distortion as well as some straightening and retracting of the nearby Cooper's ligaments. And of course, the thing we worry most about is cancer infiltration causing that distortion, but there are benign lesions that can do it as well, including sclerosing adenosis and fibrosis. And this is just a beautiful example, I think, on ultrasound of architectural distortion without really a discrete solid mass visible. So this is a long laundry list of the various pathologies for non-mass finding, and you can see there are many, many benign things that can cause non-mass findings on ultrasound. And the ones, of course, we're most interested in are the malignancies. And because invasive ductal cancer is our most common malignancy, a breast malignancy, it is more represented in malignant non-mass findings. But invasive lobular cancer, as I alluded to earlier, is also somewhat disproportionately represented in malignant non-mass ultrasound findings. And that's probably because of the growth pattern of invasive lobular cancer.
So in summary, non-mass findings on ultrasound can be subtle. It's important to see it in two views or to confirm that it's a true finding. As we discussed, it can be a wide range of benign and malignant conditions that are associated with non-mass finding. And the mammographic lesions often that have a non-mass finding correlate include asymmetries, focal asymmetries, and architectural distortion. Non-mass findings on ultrasound tend to appear as non-mass enhancement on breast MRI. So we hope you enjoyed our discussion today on non-mass findings on ultrasound. Thank you.
Thank you.